In this lecture, we will continue our discussion of cloud storage systems. We are going to study the Bigtable system from Google, which is a semi-structured data store. So what is the meaning of a semi-structured data store? It means that this is not a full traditional relational database, right? So at one extreme, you have a relational database that has a fixed schema and rows and columns and so on. On the other hand, you have key value pairs, right? Which just provide a very simple get put interface. So the semi-structured data store sits somewhere in between. It is not as complex as a full RDBMS. And on the other hand, it provides more semantics than key value stores. And Google's Bigtable basically borrows a lot of ideas from parallel and in-memory databases in order to build a high-performance, scalable system. So Bigtable provides this storage in the form of rows and columns, right? So there are a bunch of rows, and each row has several columns. And each cell, that is a row and column together, a cell, also has a timestamp, right? So you're mapping a row string, a column string, and a timestamp to a value and some array of bytes, right? That is the data storage model. We'll see an example soon. And this system is versatile enough, this data format is flexible enough that it is widely used across Google, both in batch processing as well as for real-time applications, right? And clients also have this control. They can specify whether this database is stored on disk for durability or is it stored in memory for quick access. That level of control also it provides. Therefore, it can work for both batch processing as well as real-time applications. And it is, as is the case with any cloud scale system, it is built for high availability, scalability, and performance. So this is the reference for the original paper. In this lecture, we will only cover a subset of the ideas from this paper. Like we will only touch upon the key ideas, and it is recommended that you read the paper for all the details. So first, let us see what is the data model. As I said, you have rows and columns. So for example, here you can see a row with the identifier com.cnn.ww. So rows are basically identified by strings. And this is the atomic unit of reading and writing data. And rows are sorted alphabetically. That is, you should, based on lexicographic ordering. Therefore, if two strings, the names of two rows are close together alphabetically, then the rows will be stored together. So users can pick row names. If they want some set of data to be stored together, it will be accessed together, pick the row names suitably. And a group of adjacent rows is called a tablet. And this is the data. This is the unit in which data will be distributed across machines. That is, the system will take a group of rows called a tablet, that is a subset of a table. And these tablets will be distributed across multiple nodes in the distributed system, right? Then every row has a set of columns, and these columns are also grouped into families, right? So some set of columns that store similar type of data are grouped into a family. And at this granularity of a column family, you can specify access control. You know, these users can access these column families of a row and so on. You can specify. You can also specify locality, whether to store that column in disk or memory, right? So you can say these set of columns will be stored in disk. These set of columns, I need them more often, so I'll store it in memory and so on, right? So you have rows and you have columns, which are grouped into column families. For example, here there is a row and this is one column, and these two columns belong to the same family of anchor, right? And finally, every cell, which is the intersection of a row and column, every cell has a timestamp, and multiple versions of that cell's value are stored, right? The last n versions can be stored. For example, if you look at this contents and for this row, this contents column, you have three different timestamps, three different versions being stored. Right? This is the example of a table where they store information about all the web links that are traversed, presumably for the search engine. And the API to read and write these tables is fairly straightforward. For example, on the left side here, you open a table you create a new row and you can write to the row. For example, in this row, this is the identifier of the row. Then this particular column, you can set to some value or you can delete a row, right? You can do all of these operations and you can basically create a set of operations together and you can apply all of them in one shot, right? So this is a row mutation. This is a series. This is like a transaction in databases. You've created a row mutation where multiple rows are changed and all of them together you will apply. This is how to write into the Bigtable. And here is how you read from the Bigtable. You just create a scanner which looks up a certain row and all the columns of that row and all the timestamps, all the values can be read and displayed, right? So the details, the exact function names and all are not important, but conceptually you can see how a Bigtable can be used. So now Bigtable, what they do is they reuse some of the existing systems that exist at Google already, right? They don't build everything from scratch. So before we go into the actual idea and the architecture of Bigtable, let us get a brief overview of what are the other systems that are used in building this Bigtable. So Bigtable builds on two existing systems of Google, which are called SSTable and Chubby. And this SSTable itself builds on the Google file system, which is a very famous distributed file system. Okay, so let us understand at a high level what these systems are. So SSTable is a file format that is used to store Bigtable data. Okay, and it is also used by other applications at Google. So what is an SSTable? SSTable is an immutable map of key value pairs. Okay, so you have a set of key value pairs. And once you write this SSTable, you will not change it again. You will not go back and update this value, right? You can either add values, add key value pairs, or you can read the key value pairs. But there's no notion of updating a key value pair once you've written to it, right? So it is an immutable map of key value pairs. And this is stored as a sequence of blocks, right? So this is a set of key value pairs here in one block, the next block, and so on, right? It is stored as a sequence of blocks. And each of these blocks are large blocks of 64 KB. And each of these blocks is stored in Google file system on GFS. Okay. So this is an immutable map. These terms are important to understand. It is an immutable map of key value pairs, which is organized into blocks, which is stored on GFS. So we'll see what is GFS in a little bit. It is a distributed file system that allows for replication in storing the files, in storing the blocks. So GFS will store these blocks in a fault-tolerant manner. And now if you want to look up a particular key value pair, you want to read it, right? You can, if you give a key, you can look up the value. Or you can read all the key value pairs, but there is no update operation. You cannot go and overwrite a particular value for a particular key. So why is that? It is just because we will see that this decision makes it easy to serve these key value pairs in a high performance manner. Okay. And SSTable also has an index associated with it, which is stored in memory. For every key, you will remember the block number where that key is stored, right? For every key, it's either stored in block 0 or block 1 or block N. This information is maintained in an in-memory index, which is stored in memory whenever this SSTable is opened. So what is the advantage of this? Any lookup needs only one disk access. If you want to find the value corresponding to a key, you will first read this index in memory, find the block number, then you will go to GFS and access this block and you will get the value from it, right? As opposed to if you had stored these SSTables in a regular file system, you have an inode, and if you've taken an operating systems course before, a single disk read, and to read a particular value from a file, you might have to incur multiple disk accesses, right? To read the various inodes and all the direct blocks, indirect blocks, there's a lot of metadata involved, right? So all of that can be avoided with SSTable, where you can look up with only a single disk access. And therefore it is more efficient than storing files directly on a regular file system. So that's why you don't store a key value pair in a regular file, you store it in an SSTable on GFS. So a little more detail on the Google file system itself. This is a distributed file system. This was one of the first cloud scale distributed file systems. And the beauty is you're getting a lot of good performance and fault tolerance and all of these properties on just simple commodity hardware on regular servers. So how does GFS work? It is designed to efficiently store a small number of large files. So this is not your regular POSIX API, which can store, which is a general purpose file system. So this is not a general purpose file system. This is a specialized file system to store a small number of large files. And these files are stored in a GFS cluster, that is a distributed system of nodes, where there is one master and there are multiple servers called the GFS chunk servers. And these are all regular Linux machines which they're with their attached hard drives and so on, right? And a file, a large file, is divided into chunks. And these chunks are replicated at the various chunk servers. And the master keeps track of which chunk is at which server. And at the chunk server, there's nothing special. The chunks are just stored on a regular local disk. And every chunk is identified by a unique handle, the name of the chunk. And the master maintains all this. For every file in the directory tree, it maintains the list of chunks and where they are stored, right? For each chunk is given a name, the handle, and this chunk with this handle, at which servers is it stored? That information is maintained at the master node, okay? Now, when somebody wants to read a file, they will give the file name and the chunk index, that is the offset within that file that has to be read, that is given to the master. Then the master will say, okay, this chunk is stored at so-and-so locations. It will return you back the chunk handle and the chunk locations. If you give the offset within the file, you will get back this offset that you want is actually in this chunk, which is at these locations. That information comes back to the client. Then the client can go talk to the chunk servers directly and fetch the chunk data, right? So this is a distributed file system. It works on commodity hardware. At the same time, you're getting all the desirable qualities, like you have fault tolerance because a chunk is replicated at multiple places. You're resilient to failures. You get high performance because you're able to read from multiple servers simultaneously. So you get all of these good properties in GFS. And these SS tables, the blocks, the key value pair blocks, are stored on GFS. So the next building block that Bigtable uses is what is called Chubby. So Chubby is a distributed log service, or you can also think of it as a distributed directory service. What does it mean? So Chubby exposes a directory tree of directories and files, right? So there is a namespace which has multiple directories, and within the directories there are files. And any user of Chubby can acquire a lock on any directory or any file and can read or write the contents of this file, right? So you have a set of files in a directory structure and you can lock and read or write the contents. So what Chubby guarantees is that if there are multiple users reading or writing this directory file, some kind of consistency is guaranteed across all the users. That is, this locking is distributed. If multiple people are trying to lock, only one of them will get the lock. Only one of them can update the contents of a file. Okay. So why is this useful? So this Chubby is actually quite versatile. It's used by many systems at Google. So how is it useful? Let us see a small example. Okay. Suppose you've built an application, some file server or something, right? You built it to run at just one node, a simple version you've built that runs at a single node. But of course, just running one replica is not good enough. It is not tolerant to failures and so on. And therefore, you want to migrate it to a multiple replica version for fault tolerance. Now, what do you have to do? The way you have to do it is, now you have to rewrite your application logic to have multiple replicas. These replicas will talk to each other. You know, you have to implement a full distributed system logic over here, right? These replicas might want to talk to each other to do some leader election, to decide who's the master, who will control all the updates. Some consensus algorithm has to run. So if you've taken a distributed system course, you would have seen that there are many such protocols for this, right? And this is a lot of hard work. Instead of this, instead of you implementing all of this in your application, you can simply use Chubby. For example, if all the replicas need to exchange, need to elect a master, what you can do is you all of them can try to lock a particular file. Whoever gets the lock is the master. If you have to share some information amongst the replicas, one of the nodes will write to a file and all of them will read from that file, right? So it is using Chubby is just making it easy, and you can avoid implementing all of this distributed systems, leader election and consensus algorithms and all of that. So note that there's no magic here, right? So what is happening is internally, Chubby itself is implementing a consensus algorithm. Chubby implements Paxos. So whenever you store some information in a file in this distributed directory service, Chubby itself runs across multiple replicas, and these replicas run Paxos amongst themselves in order to consistently maintain the contents of this file. So there is no magic going on. You are not eliminating all this complex distributed systems algorithms. Just that Chubby is running all of those algorithms so that you as an application can simply use it. You need not have to re-implement the logic internally. Okay, so Chubby is just a simple way to build a distributed system without you having to go through all the pain of implementing all of these complex algorithms. So in Bigtable, what happens is all the clients who are talking with Bigtable, they maintain sessions with these Chubby servers, right? And you can send requests to acquire logs, release logs, read or write contents and all of that. And Chubby servers will keep track of this content in a consistent manner. And if a session breaks, somebody is talking to Chubby, if a session breaks, then all the logs held by that client are released. So Chubby takes care of such cleanup as well. Now that we've seen all the building blocks, let us actually finally come to this Bigtable implementation. How do we implement this semi-structured data store? So there are multiple components in Bigtable. There are tablet servers, which actually store the tablets. If you recall, tablet is nothing but a group of rows which are adjacent to each other. So there are tablet servers that actually store these tablets. And there is a master which does all the management, which distributes tablets to the tablet servers, decides this assignment, does some load balancing to ensure all tablet servers are roughly equally loaded. And if some failures happen of some servers, it will redistribute the tablets. All of this management is done by the master. And the clients who are actually using Bigtable to store data, they will talk to the master occasionally to get some of this information. And later on, they will read and write tablets directly at the tablet servers. So you can see that this is the standard architecture, a master worker architecture that you find in most distributed systems. And how does the master track the tablet servers? So every tablet server stores a unique file on Chubby, right? This is where Chubby comes in. So every tablet server will create a file on Chubby and hold a lock on it. And master will periodically look at these files to find out which tablet servers are healthy and so on, right? So now because this information is consistently maintained, you don't have to run any complicated consensus algorithm amongst all the tablets to figure out the list of tablet servers. That is managed by Chubby. So the master will simply read the list of tablet servers in Chubby. So it will know which are all the tablet servers, and it will assign the tablets to these tablet servers accordingly. And if for some reason a tablet server fails, then its connection to Chubby gets lost, then that file is deleted, and therefore the master will come to know of it, and it will go ahead and assign the tablets to another tablet server, right? So the master just keeps monitoring this list of files in Chubby that each tablet server is creating. And what if the master itself fails? Then all the information about the tablet servers is there in Chubby already. The new master can restart and it can scan the list of all the tablet servers and ask them what tablets they have and basically recreate whatever the tablet assignment was. So all the main information of which tablet server has which tablets, all of this is stored in Chubby in a consistent manner. Therefore, even if failures happen, we can still recover from them. And how do you locate tablets? So every table has a set of tablets, and that information of which table has which tablet is stored in some. This is also stored in tablets, right? In this metadata of which server has which tablet of which table. All of this is also stored in some tablets once again. These are called metadata tablets. So these tablets are actual user tablets that store the rows and columns of the user, whereas these tablets store simple information about where these tablets are located. These are called the metadata tablets. And the information about all these metadata tablets is stored in another metadata tablet called the root tablet. Okay. And this root tablet is stored in Chubby. This Chubby file has this information. So if you've taken an operating systems course, you can see the analogy. This is nothing but a two-level page table, right? Like in a page table, the actual physical frame number is stored in the inner page table. And the inner page table numbers are stored in the outer page table. Similarly, instead of storing all of these metadata tablets in Chubby, we just summarize all their information, all their locations in a root tablet. And just the information about this root tablet is stored in Chubby, in a Chubby file. Okay, so tablet locations are stored in metadata tablets. And the locations of all of these metadata tablets, which server, where are they located, that information is stored in a root tablet. And this root tablet is published in Chubby by the master, right? So the master keeps track of all of this and publishes this root tablet information in Chubby. Now, if a client wants to read a particular set of rows of a particular table, it'll first query read this root tablet. From there, it'll read these other metadata tablets. From there, it'll get the information about which tablet, which server has the tablet it's looking for, right? This information it can obtain. But the client can also cache these intermediate tablets, right? Every time it's not needed to do this entire traversal, right? No need to query the master, this main file every time. You can, once you find the tablet location you're looking for, you can cache it and use it for future accesses of that tablet. And this system can store a large file size. So for example, assume tablets are 128 MB in size and each location information within the tablet, right? Information about which server has which tablet, that requires 1 KB of space within the tablet. So that means in one tablet, you can actually store 128K location information about various tablets. Okay, that is 2 to the 17 locations you can store. And now 2 to the 17 into 2 to the 17. So total 2 to the 34 location informations you can store in a two-level hierarchy. Okay. And each tablet is 128 MB. So if you multiply, you will get the maximum file size that can be handled by this hierarchy. And this is quite large enough to suffice for most applications. Now, so far we've seen a master, how it manages the locations of multiple tablets at multiple tablet servers. Now let us look inside a tablet server. Now each tablet server stores a bunch of tablets that are assigned to it by the master, right? Now let us see how this is done. So these tablets, all the persistent data that is stored in the tablets is stored on GFS, okay? So it is because GFS internally does replication at the chunk servers and all of that, as we have seen, it is enough to store one tablet at one tablet server. There is no need to replicate here because this tablet server will store it on GFS, which is doing the replication. Okay. Now, each tablet at a tablet server, there are multiple data structures in which it is stored. First, you have the SS tables, right? These are the immutable key value pairs where all the information about the rows and columns is stored. Then you have a log, a commit log, which is like if you've studied transactions in databases or in file systems, you will see that whenever you're writing something, you don't go ahead directly write it. You will write it in a log in a transaction. And when the transaction completes, then you will go ahead and do the actual write, right? So this log actually records these transactions. So you have the SS tables, which store the actual big table data. Then you have some commit logs as in how write operations are happening. And you have a mem table in memory. We'll see what this is. Okay. So this is in memory. And this log and the SS tables are on disk. And these are stored on GFS. Okay. And all of this information about which SS tables and what key value pairs are there in this tablet server, this metadata, as we've seen, is maintained in Shabby. Now, let us see what happens if you are reading or writing a particular row, a particular cell, what is happening. On the write operation, you first write all the changes into a log, into this commit log on GFS. Okay. And then all the writes are also put into the mem table. Okay. Recently committed writes are put into the mem table in memory. And note that we are only kind of doing an append kind of an operation. Okay. So no data is deleted from an SS table. So if suppose you get a request to create a row, TK, you will go ahead, add it to mem table. But if you get a request to delete a row, you will not go and go to the SS table and delete it, because deletions are not allowed. Instead, you will write a deletion record. You will just write that this row with this string identifier is deleted. That information will be recorded in mem table, but no actual deletion will be done because your SS tables are immutable. Okay. So write operation, you log it and you also keep a track of it in mem table in memory. Now on a read operation, what do you do? These are all the old data that you have. All their indexes are in memory. On top of it, you have the mem table, which is the recent changes. So if you merge all of these, you will get the final view. A particular row identified by a particular string, it's either in one of these SS tables or it is in the mem table or it has been deleted. That deletion record is there in the mem table. Some such information for each row will be stored and a merged view will be stored. And from this merged view, you will handle a read operation. If somebody wants to read a row, you will be able to say, okay, that row, it's either there in the mem table, it has been recently written to, or it's there in one of the SS tables. From this merged view, you can locate the row easily and you can return in a read operation. Note that because all of these SS tables are all sorted lexicographically, it is easy to merge, right? So this is the internal architecture of a tablet server. So why are we doing all of this? There are a few benefits here. First thing is, there is no concurrent operations at most places. The write is only updating the log and the mem table. And the read is mostly, most of these indices of these SS table files are not changing. So the only data structure where read and write are concurrently happening is this mem table, right? Only this one guy needs to be locked. Everything else can be accessed in a lock-free manner. So that is what gives you a lot of high performance when you are reading and writing, okay? So why was this immutable SS table structure chosen? Because it simplifies the design considerably. Because now you can concurrently access without locks. So multiple people can be, multiple threads, multiple clients can be reading and can be reading from the SS tables without any locks. Why? Because nobody is changing them, right? They are all immutable. They are only read only. On the other hand, if you were going ahead and modifying your rows and tables within these files itself, then every time you had to lock, and there's a lot of contention that happens. In a regular file system, you update, reads and writes happen on the same file. Therefore, it is much slower. Whereas here, you can just read at a very high throughput without any lock concurrently, because these are all read-only. The only place any locking is happening is this one data structure. And write is anyway appending to this log, which is also fast, right? So this design decisions really simplifies life a lot and can lead to very good performance, okay? There's a lot of high concurrency possible without locking. And the only place that locking is needed is the mem table. And now, of course, you can't just keep on collecting changes in the mem table, right? So periodically, once the mem table reaches a certain size, then you will compact it and make it into an SS table and store it in GFS. And periodically, of course, you might want to also merge multiple SS tables. For example, if as data gets deleted, a lot of the old SS tables will have the old data, then the new SS table will have the deletion records. So to avoid all of this, you can just read these multiple SS tables, get rid of the deletions and create a more concise, smaller set of tables, right? So periodically, all of this can happen in the background, both compacting a mem table into SS table and merging multiple SS tables. All of this happens in the background. The good part is on the critical path, whenever a read or write operation is requested, you are not going into the disk multiple times and doing all of this on the critical path for performance. And another piece of the design is that you can actually create what are called locality groups. That is, an SS table need not store a complete row. It can only store some columns belonging to one column family for each row, right? So you want to store the column families together. And you can then specify, right? You can specify that this column family, store it in disk or store it in memory. You can also specify various compression formats, and therefore the SS table will be stored accordingly, right? At the granularity of an SS table, you can enforce all of these decisions. And of course, you can also do caching. You can cache the recently read key value pairs from SS table, the recently read blocks of SS table. All of this caching can happen to improve performance at the tablet server, so that every time you're not even going to GFS to access the SS tables. So this is the summary of all the key ideas. Of course, the Bigtable paper has a lot more designs and details about a lot of other aspects of the system. But in this video, we've just covered a few important key ideas pertaining to Bigtable. So what are some of the lessons learned? One is that they've simplified the data format, right? They're not going for a full-fledged RDBMS. At the same time, they're not going for a very simple key value store. It is reasonably complex that works for a lot of applications. At the same time, the semi-structured data of column families and everything just makes it easy to optimize. And they have a decentralized master worker design. And this is the hallmark of every large scale, you know, a cloud scale system, right? That is the only way you'll scale to the huge amounts of traffic that clouds see today, right? You have a decentralized design. You can always improve performance of the system by adding more tablet servers. And these tablet servers serve data directly, right? You're not going through the master all the time. The master is only maintaining the metadata. And once a client knows at which tablet server a particular row is stored, it will directly talk to the tablet server. And therefore, if you want higher throughput, you just throw in more tablet servers into the system and your system performance will scale. And another important lesson is that you kind of build systems modularly, right? You don't have to implement all the functionality in the same system. Rather, you build smaller building blocks. You build Chubby, you build GFS, you build SS table, and then you can put these things together in a larger system, right? You can reuse functionality. For example, Chubby is used by a wide variety of systems in Google to provide this kind of a distributed locking service. So therefore, the other lesson from Bigtable is reuse functionality. That way you can incrementally build complex systems. And also some very neat design decisions they've made, right? For example, they've made this decision that I will store data as immutable tables, immutable fixed size tables, and not as general purpose files that are of arbitrary size that can be read and written to in an arbitrary fashion. Instead of that, they're storing them as immutable fixed size tables. And this gives you efficiency. This gives you the ability to read these things without locking and a lot of other benefits. Right, so they've also made a lot of design decisions that from the view of performance and efficiency are great. Right, so this is just a summary of some of the key ideas in Bigtable, and you're encouraged to read the full paper for complete details.